So we're continuing our series on the fruits of the Spirit, and we've been looking at them the last few weeks. We're going through them one by one by the weeks, and we're kind of looking at this concept of what does it look like to live a life empowered by the Spirit. You know, Galatians 5:22, they are fruits of the Spirit. The fruit is a result of the Spirit being in us, being active in us. It's the Spirit that produces the fruit. And you know, we've all been there, haven't we, where we've tried to produce patience, we've tried to produce more love, we've tried to make it happen on our own. And you know, it can go for a little while, but we understand fairly soon after that actually trying to produce those things by our own effort leads us to exhaustion. You know, it leads us to that place where we're slipping back into works, we're trying to make it happen. And so, you know, we started this series looking at what does it look like to be living in overflow. What does it look like to be in a position where everything that comes out of us is overflow? We were looking at how, you know, as Christians, we're not designed to be filled and then poured out. That's not how we're designed to live. We're designed to live in overflow. John 10:10, Jesus came that we would have life and have it in abundance. That word really means overflow. It means more than you are able to contain. And so as Christians, you're not designed to be filled and poured out. You're designed to be positioned and firmly rooted and to be filled so that it overflows. And we were looking at in Ephesians, where it talks about being filled to the fullness of the measure of God, and how, you know, when you look at that, how can you have something filled to the measure of something that is infinite? And so this idea of, you know, for us as Christians, we're designed to live in overflow. We're designed and we're purposed to be in that place of being continually filled. The Spirit is given without measure, Paul tells us. And so, you know, that idea of what does it look like for us to be so filled with the Spirit that he begins to manifest the presence and the nature and the character of Christ in us. So just even before we start, why don't you take a second and just connect with God. I mean, I know we've been worshiping, but it's so easy to get out of that mindset, to get out of that zone, to think, oh, I'm coming out of this place into now I'm in serious listen mode. And actually, you know, our heart would be that everything we do is unto encounter. It's unto having more relationship, more intimate connection with God. And so just connect with him again, just whatever that looks like for you. Just thank him that he's here. Just thank him that we were able to meet together even this morning without fear of persecution. The fact that we had the means to get here, the fact that we as a church have a means to rent this space, to buy this equipment, which apparently we're going to need to replace because the band blew the sub again halfway through worship. You know, all of these things that enable us to come and to meet together, to corporately worship, to be together. Just thank him. Just ask him to fill you up again. Be filled with the Spirit. Feels good, right? Come on. And so we're looking at peace this morning, and Tim's going to jump up and going to co-teach with Tim, which I'm excited about. He's a good man. I've known him many, many, many years. I'm going to resist the urge to tell you lots of stories because I don't want to discredit him before he comes to open the word. But once he's done preaching, come and see me afterwards. I'll give you some great stories. But you've heard me say this before, you know, peace, the peace of God, peace is not a concept. Peace is a person. Jesus Christ himself is the Prince of Peace. It says in Isaiah 9 verses 6 and 7, it's a really famous verse. We often read it at Christmas, you know, he shall be called Wonderful Counselor, you know, the Prince of Peace. Let's just turn there quickly. If you've got your Bibles, if you haven't got your Bibles, we'll just assume you memorized the whole thing. I'll come around and do a spot test for you. Really famous section of scripture. This is Isaiah 9, verse 6. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. I love that. I never saw that before, just as I was preparing. I've always thought about of the increase of his government, there shall be no end. But of the increase of his peace, there shall be no end. That talks to me about actually peace is something that we can grow in. Peace is something that, you know, again, it's not just a concept. It's a person. We grow in relationship with God. And as we grow in relationship with God, we grow in our ability to be in peace. And what we're going to look at this morning, just really simply, is three kind of aspects of peace. And they each relate to each other. And they each have a flow. And so, you know, good classic three-point sermon. But the first thing I want to look at is peace with God. How do we find peace with God? And then Tim's going to come up and talk about how do we find peace within ourselves. And then I'm going to finish us up by talking about how do we pursue peace with one another. And actually seeing how each of those three flow. And you can't look for peace within yourself if you haven't found peace with God. And you can't pursue peace with other people if you're not at peace within yourself. And so looking at that journey and that flow, what does it look like to have peace with God, which in turn leads us to have peace within ourselves, which in turn will lead us to want to pursue that manifestation of peace with our brothers and sisters. So why don't you just look at your neighbor? So I'm going to make peace with you at some point today. But I'm going to sort myself out first. So let's turn to Philippians 4. Philippians chapter 4, I'm going to read from verse 4. And again, really well-known passage, I just want to pull a few ideas out of this. So Philippians 4, verse 4, I'm going to read through to verse 7. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. I know a song about that, it's a good song. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say, go on then, rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord. You guys are a tough crowd this morning. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. I love that. How evident is your gentleness? You know, when you are something instead of trying to be something, you won't have to communicate that to other people. You know, the more someone has to walk around and tell you they're a person of peace, the good chances are that they're not a person of peace. And you know, this fruit isn't fake it till you make it. This fruit is the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Let your gentleness be evident to all. Ask yourself this question, or maybe ask your neighbor this question, might be a better. How evident is your gentleness? How evident is it? Is it something that you have to muster up? Or is it something that comes more naturally to you? Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. I love that. That's just a sentence on its own. Let your gentleness be evident to all. Full stop. The Lord is near. Full stop. Just take a second and just dwell on that. The Lord is near. You know, there's a difference between omnipresence and manifest presence. Or as my wife likes to say, there's a difference between being in the room and in the room. And I do that thing that husbands do. I'm like, you said the same thing. I don't know what you mean. And what she means is, you know, it's like when she says fine, I'm like, it's a trap. I don't know what you mean, but you are clearly not fine. And then she says the thing that really terrifies me. I'm like, well, what's wrong? And she's like, if you don't know, then you're, and it's like, if you don't know, you're really in trouble. Oh my gosh. Just back out of the room slowly. The Lord is near. The difference between omnipresence and manifest presence. You know, the Lord is everywhere. He's omnipresent. But there's a difference between omnipresence and manifest presence. The Lord is near. He's not just in the room because he's everywhere. He's near. He's chosen to draw near. I love that verse. You know, draw near to the Lord and he will draw near to you. This idea of closeness and intimacy. Do not be anxious about anything. I love that. Do not. That's a command. Did you know that? Did you know anxiety is rebellion? Because you've been commanded to not be anxious. Who here is anxious? No, don't. Just, I mean, maybe ask yourself that question. Maybe just close your eyes for a second. Sorry, I'm trying to not be my bossy preacher. I invite you to close your eyes. I'm on this little thing at the moment, not being a bossy preacher. I invite you to close your eyes just for a second. And just like the psalmist, ask Holy Spirit, shine a light on my heart. Show me if there's any wicked way within me. Is there any, in what areas of my life am I currently anxious? And just in the most loving way, I want to rebuke you that anxiety is rebellion because you have been commanded to not be anxious. All scripture is God-breathed. And so when Paul writes here, do not be anxious, that's a command from the Lord. Do not be anxious about anything. But in everything, you can open your eyes again. Sorry, I'd like to invite you to open your eyes again. If you don't want to, you can just close your eyes through the whole sermon. Might look better for you. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition. I love that as well. Do you know there's an order here? Because who does those prayers where you like to advise God? Where you like to kind of, you know, you fill God in on some of the salient details you feel like you might have missed? Me and Roz, yeah. The rest of you obviously just, you know, praying the will of the Lord. But I know for me, so often I go to petition before I've gone through the process of prayer. And there's a difference between prayer and petition. Prayer is about communication. Prayer is about speaking to God about stuff. Petition is about asking him to change stuff. Do you know the danger of going to petition before you go to prayer? Is you try and instruct the will of the Lord before you've discerned the heart of the Lord. And so often I think the reason we don't see breakthrough in our prayers is we're praying, my will be done, not your will be done. We say, my way, not your way. You know, there's a flow, there's a reason. Yeah, I know, right? The old ones are the good ones. By prayer and petition. And so this whole thing about, God, before I want to ask you to do something, I want to get your heart on something. Because so often when I've taken the time to get God's heart about something, actually I end up praying differently to how I would have prayed beforehand. Because so often his, you know, who knows, his thoughts are above our thoughts, his ways are above our ways. His wisdom is above our wisdom. And so often I approach my prayer, but I start with petition. I ask God to do something, and I think that that's going to get me the answer that I want. You know, it says the prayers of the righteous availeth much, right? Who knows that verse? Where do we get our righteousness? From Christ. It's the righteousness of Christ that's been imputed to us. And so it's been given to us. It's credited to us, it says. And so for us to understand that before we get into petition, we need to talk to God about stuff. We need to, you know, your goal with prayer should be to seek the heart of the Lord. So your goal in petition can be to pray the will of the Lord. And that's, if you pray the will of the Lord, you'll always see prayers answered. You know, Jesus never had a prayer go unanswered, but he only ever did what he saw the Father doing. And only ever said what he heard the Father saying. So he was so in the will of God that to pray was just decreeing the will of God. Just a thought. That's not what I'm preaching about. Thanksgiving, present your requests to the Lord. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. The peace of God that passes all understanding. You don't need to understand it to receive it. You don't need to understand it necessarily. So often we try to perceive before we receive. Who does that? We like to figure it out before we receive it. I want to logically understand it before I'll receive it. And you've heard me say this before. It doesn't say see and taste that the Lord is good. It says taste and see that the Lord is good. And so often we're looking to understand the peace of God before we've received. Don't look to perceive before you receive. Receive it and then perceive it. And so often we say I'll believe it when I see it, but actually it's I'll see it when I believe it in the kingdom. And so don't allow that. If you're looking for peace in your life, just know that the peace of God that transcends understanding will guard your hearts and minds. Some other references to peace. 1 Thessalonians 5:23, the God of peace guards your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. That's where we find peace, in Christ Jesus. 1 Peter 1 verse 2, peace, may peace be yours in abundance. I love that. Go do some study on that word abundance. I haven't looked at it, but I would guess that it would be that word that we've looked at before, peresos, which is this idea of, that the analogy I gave was filling a pint glass with a fire hose. That kind of peace can be yours in abundance. The peace of God that transcends understanding can be yours in the same way that you are a pint glass looking for peace and God is a fire hose giving you that peace. That's the kind of peace I need in my life, especially trying to stay peaceful preaching in front of you lot. Okay, Romans 5. How do we get peace with God? Let's turn to Romans 5 quickly. Really well-known passage, this the whole concept of being justified by faith. Romans 5, verse 1. Therefore, what have we learnt with Scripture? If you see a therefore, you've got to find out what it's there for. So let's just go back a little bit. Verse 23. The words, it was credited to him, this is talking about Abraham, were not written for him alone, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness. There's that idea of the righteousness of Christ being imputed to us. Righteousness literally means to be right before God, to be perfect and blameless before God. Who here is glad that you can come before God and be righteous? You should be glad, because if you come before God and you're not righteous, you know what happens? That's why it's good to get. No, that's old covenant, don't worry. Just be thankful that you're living in the new covenant, not the old covenant, because sometimes we turn up to church with junk in our hearts and do that in the old covenant. Die. All right, calm down. It was credited to him, were written not for him alone, but for us, to whom God will credit righteousness, for us who believe in him, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. He was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. Therefore, since we have been justified, past tense, therefore, since we have been justified, i.e. it's already happened, we have peace with God, also past tense. Peace isn't something we need to try and attain with God. Peace is something we already have with God. We just need to catch up to that realization. So many of the promises that we get are future. You know, the kingdom is the now and not yet. It's, you know, the kingdom has come, the kingdom is coming, the kingdom will come. You know, he who was and is to come. So much of the kingdom is the now and not yet. But the peace of God that comes through being justified is already have it, need to catch up with it, as opposed to trying to attain it. Does that make sense? Okay. Some of you aren't convinced, but don't worry. Me and Tim, we're going to get there. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. Peace with God comes through justification, through the cross of Christ. You know what justification means, justified? It's just if I'd never sinned. And I want to challenge us that so often we lose the mystery of that simple truth. We get all mature and we think we're doing really well in maturity, but actually we slip back into this whole beating ourselves up about our sin, don't we? Don't we? We kind of stay in this perpetual state of self-flagellation. Like, it's weird. We hear the gospel and we go through that honeymoon period of I've been justified and he's paid the price. And then somewhere along the line, we lose that simple truth, that simple beauty of the gospel. And we get back into this kind of beating ourselves up. And do you know the guise it comes in? The way the enemy talks to us is, you should know better. You should know better. But actually, to live in a place of peace, first and foremost, we need to daily remind ourselves that we have peace with God. We've been made right before God. We have peace with him. You know, you can't have peace from God until you've made peace with God. Do you know, Scripture describes us as we were enemies of God. Before the blood of Jesus covered us, we were enemies of God. We made peace. We decided to throw down our weapons. We decided that we were defeated. And he, you know, I said before, the word gospel, the euangelion, would have been used in two ways. One, to proclaim the death or capture of the enemy. Or two, to proclaim that there's a soon coming wedding. Part of the gospel truth is that the enemy has been defeated and captured, right? And so that peace with God that comes, understanding that we have peace with God, and then because of that, we can receive peace from God. Just a quick testimony on this, and then I'm going to get Tim up to speak to us about peace within ourselves. Have you ever, you know when you lay out in the sun, and, well, I mean, we live in Wembley, you guys are probably like, what? What is the sun you speak of? It sounds glorious. You know, on the off chance that you manage to get out of Wembley sometime and you experience this big burning, ball of fire in the sky, which we affectionately call the sun. I saw it once on holiday. It was amazing. And, have you ever been out in the sun and a cloud goes across the sun and you feel the cold all of a sudden, don't you? And then, you know, like when you've got your eyes closed and the cloud peels away and the sun comes back out and first of all, you perceive the light, okay? You're aware of the light, and it takes a couple of seconds for the warmth to hit your face. And that feeling when the warmth hits your face, you know that delicious feeling? It's so good, isn't it? Oh, just kind of think about how I want to go and get a cold beer and go on holiday and sit in the sun for a whole week. It'd be amazing. That feeling, and I've been through this journey the last few years of, God gave me that picture a couple of years ago, and you'll see me sometimes, I'll just look up, and I'll just smile, and what I'm waiting for is to feel the smile of heaven over me. To feel it, because I know in my heart of hearts that I've been made right with God. But sometimes I lose touch of that truth. I feel disconnected from that truth. It's a head knowledge truth, but it's not a heart knowledge truth. You know, the longest journey in the world is from your head to your heart, right? We believe, we know it's true, but we're not experiencing it in that moment. And just taking that second to just, in the same way that the cloud of doubt peels away, and I see the light. And I'm aware of the light. I'm aware of the truth. But it takes a couple of seconds of meditating on that truth before I'm warmed to it. Does that make sense? And in the same way, I catch myself doing that more and more now. When I catch those moments where I'm suddenly aware of sin, or I'm suddenly aware of something I've done wrong, I'm suddenly aware of a shortcoming, some area where the peace of God hasn't been manifest through me, or the fruit of the Spirit hasn't been manifest through me. It's usually Monday morning, I'll be honest. And I take that second and I wait for that smile of heaven. Because I want that to be the thing that drives me. I want that to be the thing that reminds me that I have peace from God because I have peace with God. So just as Tim comes up, just take a second and just going to ask you just one little ministry time. Come on up, mate. We just take a second and just close your eyes and just reconnect with that simple truth. That if you are saved, if you've been made one with Christ, that you have peace with God. And because of having peace with God, you can then experience peace from God. And just, if that picture helps you, just picture that cloud peeling away and the sun coming out and the light hits you. You're aware of the light. You're aware of the truth. And then in a couple of seconds, you start to feel the warmth, the heat radiate into your face. And that's what I'm talking about, is living under the smile of heaven, knowing that I have peace with God. And that peace is not a concept. That peace is a person.
Shalom. Why don't you turn to your neighbor and say shalom to them? You know, peace was a really common kind of sort of salutation in Jesus' time. So when you met someone in a conversation, you would say shalom or peace to them. And as you left the conversation again, you would say shalom. So like you'd hear sort of Arab nations saying salam, which means peace as well. It's a really similar word. But when Jesus in the Bible says, you know, peace I leave you with, not the world's peace, but my peace, that's him kind of finishing the conversation as they thought he would, but then talking about such a deeper level of peace than they understand. So I'm going to talk about peace within ourselves, this kind of like inner peace. And it's good what Tom was saying about, you know, the longest journey sometimes is from your head to your heart. And sometimes what can happen is there's a bit of a disconnect in there. And it leads to a kind of a disunity within yourself. And that for me, I found is like the biggest robber of peace. And it's great that I can speak on this today, because honestly, this I'm like preaching to myself this morning. I want you to know I'm soon to be a dad in 6 weeks. And it's amazing. And I love kids. And I know once I have my son in my arms, it'll all be fine. But that way, I'm like, what's it going to look like? What's it going to do? How much sleep am I going to get? What am I going to be like at work? What am I going to be like with my wife? It's so many questions, and it just like gets there. And I know for me, I've really been experiencing, I think anxiety is the best way to put it. I've really been kind of, over the last couple of weeks, really experiencing that and talking to God a lot about it. And so for me to preach on inner peace today is great, because it's just for me. So if you guys don't get anything, that's fine. This is just for me then. So peace within ourselves. The biggest challenge to inner peace is disunity. And so a good way to look at it is, who's ever been to an all-you-can-eat breakfast in here? One or two of us, yeah? And you know what happens? You know, you get to that point where suddenly you're starting to feel full, but there's an extra sausage. Or we can go back for seconds and get another hash brown. And we have this kind of internal struggle. What do I do? Do I take the extra sausage? And your mind is telling you no, but your body is telling you yeah. And that's how it is. And it's funny, but the other side of that is, I know that when I'm in my car and there's a driver about to cut me up, all I want to do is beep at him and give him some justice. Who knows that feeling? You know, who knows the feeling when somebody's being annoying at work or being annoying at church? You know, not that that would ever happen, but it kind of feels good to gripe a little bit. It kind of feels good to mock them behind their back. And there's this kind of inner turmoil in us where it's like, I know this is wrong, but it kind of feels nice. But that inner disunity is what comes in and robs your peace. And it's serious. And peace within ourselves is so important. After we have peace with God, we need to be united in ourselves. Jesus said, Father, I pray that they would be one. And I really believe that means as much with your neighbor as it is with yourself. So, let's go to Romans. Can we go to Romans chapter 8, verses 5 to 9? So chapter 8, verse 5. You know, earlier, Paul says, I do not understand my own actions, for I do what I want. I don't do what I want, but I do the very thing that I hate. And I really understand Paul, because I know there's times when I know what is right and they end up doing what is wrong. And it burns inside of me, and I sit there and it's like Tom said, there's this self-flagellation that comes out, and we just want to like beat ourselves down. We want to punish ourselves, because Jesus isn't going to do it. Jesus isn't going to punish you, but yeah, you want to punish yourself. We appoint ourselves as judge over Jesus. And we say, actually, we're going to punish ourselves. And again, it robs us of peace. So let's, Romans 8. I was going to say read it with me, but I'm aware we've got like 20 different translations out here. So we'll give it a go. So Romans 8, verse 5. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. To set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. So for the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. It's impossible. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you. And if you want to know why peace is a fruit of the Spirit, it's because you can't get it unless the Spirit of God dwells in you. It's impossible. It won't happen. It says that only the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace. And that's what we want. And so that's the very reason why peace is that fruit of the Spirit, is because we can't get that without God. And so you need peace to get peace, in a sense. Like Tom said, with our peace with God, he makes us right with him. He makes us have peace with God so we can then have peace in our relationship with God. And in the same way, we need the Holy Spirit to give us peace so that we can live in peace with him. It's standard with the Bible. There's so many things where it's like both at the same time, both and. And so that's where that peace comes from. But what I wanted to do was just explain a little bit to you guys about where disunity can occur within ourselves and how we deal with it. And this is great because this is what I've been praying over myself all week as I've been preparing this. And it's all to do with our spirit being led by Holy Spirit, setting our mind on the Holy Spirit and being led by Holy Spirit. And as we do that, it brings ourselves into unity. And so I'm going to just take three terms. So spirit, yeah, body, soul. Good, we got there with the last one. So spirit, body, soul. We are triune people from a triune God. And God calls us to be one, but throughout the New Testament, it talks about your spirit, your body, and your soul in the same verses, because they had an understanding that we are made up of different parts, and how we work comes out of those parts. So I'm going to really quickly run through them and explain them. So the spirit, say spirit. So spirit is the core of you. It's something that is created in God and redeemed in Christ. Everyone has a spirit. But only in the death and resurrection of Christ is our spirit renewed and restored to God, if that makes sense. So if you don't know Jesus today, and if you haven't sort of entered into a relationship with him and recognized him as Lord, then your spirit is not in a place of being awakened to God. And it's not being in a place of being restored and made one and at peace with God. And so the Holy Spirit, it says in Romans, oh, this is so bad if I got it wrong. I'm pretty sure it's Romans. It says in Romans, it says that the Holy Spirit testifies to our spirit that we are sons of God. And so it's his spirit testifying to our spirit. And that relationship is where our spirit is renewed in Christ. And your spirit is completely renewed in him at once, at salvation. That's what I wholly believe. And so you are one and you are righteous in him because of that. Perfect, okay? Your soul. So your soul is kind of where your passions come from, where your desires come from, your feelings, your emotions. It all comes from this place, the soul inside of you. And the soul it's a catch of fire term. It's on the journey. Let's put it like that. And so your soul is that place where you are making those everyday choices. Do I choose God or do I choose the world? Do I choose God's truth or do I actually just allow myself to feel this fear? And it's not bad. Your soul is happy. Your soul is joyful. Your desires are godly and God leads you in them. But it's this process of transformation. And it's this process that will carry on. I really believe until we are united with God in the resurrection. And that is when we finally do that. But we are constantly being renewed and restored in Christ. And that's what the Bible says. You know, your nature is transformed by the renewal of your mind. And our souls are restored. In Psalm 23, everyone knows it. It's really famous. But the Lord is my shepherd. I say everyone knows it. I'm going to double check it because I don't want to do it in the wrong order. The Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures and he leads me beside still waters and he restores my soul. God wants to restore your soul. God wants you to make right decisions. It's that life and death choice that we often talk about. Choose life. He is restoring your soul, and it's an amazing place to be. I love that I'm human. Do you know what? I really love that. I really love that I get to choose God, because I really believe there'll be a day that I'm so captivated by him that there kind of is no choice anymore. But at this present time, I get to choose God, and I love getting to do that, and he really loves seeing us do that. Mary's choice, when she found out that she is pregnant with Jesus, you know, she says, "My soul magnifies the Lord." And there's her understanding is that actually that's her choice. That's her very passions and her desires, the choices she makes in life, and she chooses to magnify God with it. So your soul is great. I want you to understand soul, body, spirit, they're all great. they're on different stages of that journey though. So our body, the last one, our body is again is in the process of sanctification, which means it's getting there, but it's not fully there yet. Amen? Good. Pinch yourself if you want. Don't pinch your neighbor. That would be mean. Just pinch yourself. Do you feel it? Yeah? That's because you're real. That's because you still feel pain. You can still feel that. And you know, it says in heaven, there's no more weeping, there's no more tears, there's no more pain. And our bodies are going to be so renewed in God in the resurrection that they're going to be so real that we can walk through doors and we can walk through walls. And God has given you this incredibly new, restored body that is going to be incredible. But we're on that journey right now. And we'll see more healings and we'll see more miracles and we'll see more people raised from the dead as he does that process. And as Jesus returns, and who knows, that time is getting sooner. It's coming. It's getting sooner. And so we're going to see that more and more. That's what we're designed to do. But at the moment, we're still in that process. And our body still will one day decay and die. And unless you're raptured, that will happen. But you get resurrected. Amen? I said amen, not amen. Interesting. So, spirit is here. It's made it. It's there. It's totally restored in God. Your body and your soul are still catching up. And who knows that the distance on that journey can sometimes create a little bit of friction. Yeah? There are days when I know that God is like, Tim, you're amazing. You're going to have a great day. You're going to see people change at work. You're going to see their lives transform. You're going to see him heal. And my soul is like, it's Monday morning. I don't know how to feel. I don't know if I'll get through the day. My body is just like, I'm too tired to move. Let's just do this all the way to work. It happens. It's really, really real. And I don't hate it. Because I know that we can make the choices to get there. And I know God is restoring me and renewing me to get there. But it's good to recognize that actually sometimes there is a bit of conflict or disunity within ourselves. And we need God to come and bring unity to ourselves. You know, I've seen people I love to pieces and struggle for years and years and years with chronic pain. And it is horrific and I hate it. And I know for them that they've heard, they read their Bible and they hear people teach all the time, God is a healer. And he is. But some of their experiences they've had, it's been of disappointment because at that time they weren't healed. And that's hard. It's not easy. And their body is still feeling that pain and every day they still feel that pain. And I know for them, you know, the biggest challenge is, can I make that choice to believe what my spirit believes in God and believe that as the truth for my life? And it's hard and it's not easy. And I think those choices are going to be there, you know, throughout our life until we're completely renewed and restored in Christ, that we're still going to make choices every day to actually be like, I'm going to stand here in my spirit as a son of God and believe what he says about me. Even though my body might not be feeling it and my soul might be just struggling with that fear. And God has called us to unity. 1 Thessalonians 5:23. It says, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The God of peace sanctifies you completely, complete and whole. Jesus says, my prayer is that they would be one. Not just unity with God, not just unity with others, but unity within themselves. And in the biblical kind of understanding of peace, is a huge part of it is that kind of unity, is prosperity, is a complete wholeness. And when we talk about inner peace, peace within ourselves, we need to understand that actually there's a need for us to become unified under our spirits, under Holy Spirit. The mindset on the spirit is life and peace. And so my prayer this week as I've been preparing this and I've been learning kind of what to pray has been, Lord, I want my soul and my body to come under the leadership of my spirit, because my spirit knows his truth. And my spirit, I want you to be led by Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, would you testify to my spirit that I am a son of God? And would that be the place where I make my decisions from? And would that be the place that I am led from? And would that be the place where I have peace in myself, in oneness with God? And so that's what I really want. That's what unity is within ourselves. What peace is within ourselves is actually just allowing ourselves to sit in that place of being led by his spirit. And the great thing about it is it's not you saying, oh, come on, I've got to drag my soul and my body along. It's actually just you saying, just come under leadership and Holy Spirit, lead me. And as he leads you, it says he leads you beside still waters and he restores your soul. And he will restore your body. But standing in that place of being unified in yourself and with God and allowing his peace to come over you is just the best thing. And that at the moment is like what I'm holding on to, because I know God has great plans for my life. And I know God has an amazing son for me. And I'm so excited to meet him. And I don't want, like Tom said, I don't want to live in rebellion and have anxiousness. I want to live in freedom and being led by God. So that's what I want. And we're going to pray more into this later, but I'll get Tom back up. Why don't you just close your eyes as Tom comes up? He did it, so I'll do it. Close your eyes. And why don't you just do what I've done? Just say, I just right now I command my soul and my body to come under the leadership of my spirit. And Holy Spirit, would you lead my spirit? Lead me into peace and unity with you. Amen.
So good, so good. So peace with God, peace within ourselves, and finally peace with others. And we're just going to fly through this, and then we're going to get into some ministry. So the outworking of peace with God will be peace within yourself. One will follow the other. But similarly, peace within yourself will cause you to pursue peace with others. You know, it's interesting. I often think that there are people who willingly hold that grudge. Abby used to say it. She used to say, if I forgive that person, then they won't get what they deserve. And which used to make me laugh. You know, so often we hold that grudge because we don't want to pursue peace with people. We've been hurt or we've been wounded, or we feel like they need to own it. They need to ask for repentance before we forgive them. Who's ever been in that kind of situation? I'm not going to forgive them till they say they're sorry. And I've taught on this before. God didn't wait for you to say you were sorry before he forgave you. And so it's fairly arrogant of us to expect the same from others. You know, do unto others as you would have done to yourself. And so I believe that the forgiveness of God happened at the cross, and our repentance is about entering into that. And in the same way, we should be pursuing peace with others. You know, Jesus didn't say, blessed are the peacekeepers. He said, blessed are the peacemakers. There's a difference between keeping the peace and making the peace. And usually that's what we do. We tell ourselves that we're making peace with people, but all we're doing is keeping the peace. How do you keep the peace? You know what peacekeepers do? They stand there with guns to keep the peace. That's not peace. Peacekeepers stand there and say, if you step out of line, the peacemakers put down their arms and make peace. And so I want to challenge you, you know, who are the people in your life? What are the relationships in your life where you're telling yourself, you're kidding yourself that you've made peace with them, but all you're doing is keeping peace? Blessed are the peacemakers, not the peacekeepers. Making peace is about making a choice to choose peace. And sometimes that's a daily choice. Sometimes that's a daily process we have to go through. We have to. I've said this before, but there's someone who hurt me very much in my childhood. I'm not going to say the name because we do podcasts. but regularly, whenever I go through forgiveness, that name always comes up. You know, you kind of do the standard list: your mum, your dad, your sisters. We always put, you know, our leaders on the list. So my list normally goes, you know, mum, dad, and Martha and Joe and Abby and Stu and Chloe, and then this other name. And I kind of always feel like I have to justify, like, this isn't like an ex-wife or something like that, like, because this name literally comes up every single time, because there was such a depth of hurt from this person that it had to be almost a daily choice to seek peace, to seek forgiveness, to seek, you know, the ministry that Jesus had was the ministry of reconciliation. That's the ministry you've been called into. When he quoted from Isaiah in Luke 4, I think it is, where Jesus opens the scroll and he reads from the scroll of Isaiah, and he reads from Isaiah 61, I think it is, you know, the year of the Lord is on me, because he's anointed me to preach good news, you know, to proclaim liberty to the captive. And he says to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, and then he rolls up the scroll. And he misquoted. I mean, you know, people talk about, you know, taking a scripture out of context. Jesus did it. Just a thought. He omitted the last bit of Isaiah 61, which is, and the acceptable day of the vengeance of our Lord. And that was his manifesto for his ministry. That was his manifesto for the gospel, that the gospel is not a gospel of vengeance. It's a gospel of reconciliation. Vengeance is the Lord's, not yours. Like Tim was saying, are you appointing yourself judge over the Lord? He doesn't condemn them, so why should you? And so we, our ministry is a ministry of reconciliation. God is reconciling all things to himself, and you need to follow suit. The Prince of Peace lives in you, but he wants out. Not he wants out like he doesn't want to live in you anymore, but you know. So, but we do that, don't we? We say, oh God, I want the Prince of Peace to live in me, but I don't want the Prince of Peace to live in them. Grace and mercy for me, justice for them. You don't know what they did. No, I don't know what they did, but I know what he did. I don't know why we always just, kind of in most churches, we would have a cross at the front. I'm not referring to the drummer. When I point, I'm referring to Jesus. I know what he did. How arrogant of me to expect God to be a peacemaker with me, but to think that I get away with being a peacekeeper with my brother or my sister. And I want to propose to you that if you are not actively pursuing being a peacemaker with your brother and sister, the chances are there's a lack of peace within yourself, which may itself come from a lack of understanding of the peace you hold with God. And so I just want to challenge you that that flow needs to happen. We need to understand and meditate on the fact that we have peace with God. And because we have peace with God, we get peace from God. And the peace from God causes the peace within ourselves. But that should be a manifestation. It should be a fruit. Other people should be able to taste and see that your fruit is good. Be like God. Make peace with your enemies. Paul said it himself, imitate me as I imitate Christ. Be like Christ. Do you know what Christ did? He made peace with his enemies. Do you know who his enemies were? You. Turn to your neighbor, say, you. Be like God. And you're like, people are like, oh, do you think you're God? Well, no, I don't think I'm God. I think I'm the house of God. And I think he lives in me and he's always home. And so, again, it's not that thing. You can't choose when you have God living in you and when you don't. You can't choose that, oh, I want the signs and the wonders, but I don't want to. Do you see what I mean? Oh, we want the fire to fall on Pentecost, but we don't want to preach the gospel so thousands get saved. Yeah? I want to be called as a disciple, but I don't want to be a fisher of men. You can't make peace with God and not pursue peace with your neighbor. The two don't go together. If you are not pursuing, if you don't have a heart to pursue peace, you probably need more of God's heart. And that's the whole point of the fruit of the Spirit. If you don't have that patience, the prayer isn't, I need more patience. The prayer is, I need more of you, Holy Spirit, to produce that nature in me. Let's just turn our last scripture before we finish. Ephesians 4, verse 3, then we're going to wrap up. Love this. Don't you just love Ephesians? Ephesians 4, I'm going to read from chapter 1. Chapter 4, verse 1. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling. What's your calling? The ministry of reconciliation. Worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble. Be completely humble. Isn't that cool? I think I'm doing well. I think I'm probably the most humble person I know. Be completely humble and gentle. That was a joke. Just chill out, people. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort. Every effort. Make every effort. Don't make some effort. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to be one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. That is why it says, when he ascended on high, he led captives in his train and gave gifts to men. And it goes on to talk about unity in the body. And like Tim was saying, there needs to be unity in the body in respect to us being in Christ. We're crucified with him, we died with him, we raised with him. There's unity in that body. There then needs to be unity in our body, mind, soul, body, spirit, all of our stuff coming under unity to our spirit, coming under the authority of our spirit. But there also needs to be unity in the body around us as well. And so in those three representations of the body of the Godhead, the body of us within our own body, and the body of believers, the body of Christ. There needs to be unity. Do you know if you are actively seeking disunity with someone else in the body, you are causing the body of Christ to be crippled? Think about it. If the forearm deliberately seeks distance from the wrist, the hand becomes ineffective. And in the same way, pursuing unity with the body of Christ causes the body of Christ to become more effective, more efficient. And so just think on that as well. What part of us, even as a body, as a church, what areas of our church life are ineffective and crippled because there are people who aren't being peacemakers? There's a sobering thought. And on that jolly note, would you like to stand? We're going to pray for you. remember I was talking about the kingdom of God is the now and not yet? It's interesting how Paul doesn't tell us to create the bond of peace. He tells us to preserve the bond of peace. Unity isn't something you create. Unity is something you preserve. We've been unified in Christ, and we are doing our every effort to preserve it, not create it. And so we're going to lead a time of ministry. Tim, why don't you jump up here as well? We're going to lead a time of ministry. And what we felt as we were chatting and preparing was we wanted to offer a kind of almost like a ministry conveyor belt. And so Dan and Ashley and their merry band of ministry team are going to aid us in this. But to your left, to our right, we're going to have station one. And this is the Peace with God station. Okay, and then we're gonna ask everyone, no matter where on this journey you feel you're doing really well and where you need to grow, I'm guessing all of us can have something that we can take away from those three stages where we know. You know, we might be fine with our peace with God, but we're feeling a bit of disunity and dispeace in ourselves. But I'm going to encourage you to go through that process and just stay longer where you feel you need the more work, okay? But what I'm going to challenge you to do, front left, we're going to have station one, which is the Peace with God station. We're going to have some ministry team here. Then in the middle, we're going to have the Peace within ourselves station, ministry team there. And then over here, we're going to have the peace with other people, peace with our brothers and sisters in Christ station. And what we're going to encourage you to do, if you want to respond, is to come up and just take a moment at each station and just do that journey, do that process of having ministry into peace with God, to receive the peace from God that comes from reconciliation, knowing that we're justified through the blood of Christ, that his righteousness has been imputed to us. The second station, that peace within ourselves, if there are any of you that are feeling a sense of disunity, remember that in Psalm 133, where brothers live in unity, that's where the Lord bestows his blessing. What's the blessing? Life. If you want life in abundance, if you don't feel like you're living an abundant life, there's a good chance that's a result of there being some form of disunity inside of you. And then coming out of that into this station, and you may not think that there's anyone you're not living in peace with. I want to challenge you to ask Holy Spirit. See what he brings up. See what he reveals. If there's someone that you need to make peace with, go and read what Paul says about coming and taking communion when you have something against your brother. I just want to challenge us as a community that we are pursuing intentional relationship. High honor, high confrontation. We don't want to allow things to fester. We don't want to allow a bitter root to come up that's going to defile many. That's what scripture says. And so being in that place where, just like my good friend Dan, if there's something that's bothering us, we go to that person and we talk to them in love. Do you know the result of him challenging me on something that was wrong in my life was I felt loved and encouraged, not admonished and condemned. I felt convicted to live a life of the calling that's on me. Does that make sense? What does that look like to have godly confrontation that's bathed in godly honor? Well, what it looks like is I'm a better person as a result of it. He's edified the body by edifying me. Does that make sense? Okay, so over here, what have we got? In the middle, what have we got? Over here, what have we got? Okay, and then as you come out of that ministry time, we're looking forward to hearing testimonies in the week. We want to encourage you guys to activate this. Feedback to your fire group leaders, feedback to your ministry leaders. What has God done as a result of you not only being hearers of the word, but doers of the word? Yeah? Amen. Okay, so ministry team, if we could just have you forward. If you could split yourselves into three equal clumps. I don't know if that's the collective noun for ministry team, clumps. We're going to have suitable ministry music. There we go. Wonderful. So I'm going to pray. Actually, Tim's going to pray. And then we're going to invite you forward. So I encourage you to start over here, peace with God. Move into that peace within ourselves. And then over here, if you need some help and coaching about how to be peacemakers with someone, please come and talk to me. If you need some help with that, don't come to me to gossip. Come to me to find a solution to make peace with someone that you need to make peace with. I don't want to hear about the problem. I want to help you in terms of pursuing that person to be a peacemaker, not a peacekeeper. Amen? So Tim's going to pray and then we're going to move into ministry.
Spirit, we welcome you here. We welcome your fruit, the fruit that comes from you, the fruit that is tended to by you. And I just ask this room right now be filled with your peace. And Lord, I thank you we are at peace with you. I thank you have brought us into oneness in ourselves, and you have called us into unity with others. And I thank you that the peace you give us is not the peace that the world has, but it's a greater peace. Shalom. It's deeper. It's wider. It's greater in your love. God, I ask for every single person in this room, God, that there would be just be an upgrade in their peace. Greater levels of peace for every single person. Holy Spirit, come and do what you want to do. Come and lead us in this. If you want to just come forward, go for it. Come and get some prayer. Come and give yourselves over to the Prince of Peace.
Tom and Tim have said, if you come to the first station, but I just want to encourage you when you come, this isn't the time for deep ministry, this isn't the time for an RTF kind of approach, this is the time for you to in faith grab hold of what God has for you in this moment. And so when you come for the peace for self, you're coming for an impartation of peace for self. And that is so simple and so straightforward. That's saying, yeah, I'm having it and I'm going to take it for myself, and then moving to receiving peace with God. And in these, I want to encourage you to almost approach it like you're walking in the light with it. And so if you need to repent, then you can do that before someone's even laid a hand on you. And you can repent for not being allowing peace in your life, and then receive a blessing in that. And then when you come to the middle one, you can repent with God. But the last one, and most importantly, I want to encourage you with the last stage. What we're going to do is, it's not a chance for you to lay a load of judgments about someone in front of these guys, or to go into deep ministry. What it is a chance for you to say, God, these are the relationships I know I haven't had peace in, and I want to see your restoration in that. And then the guys are going to bless those relationships over you, and then it's your job and your journey to take what you're receiving this morning and apply it to your life. And so we just want to bless you. But as you're coming to each station, it might feel like you need to go into a deep place with this, but I want to encourage you that you can approach it like a buffet. You can pick up what you need, and then you can move to the next thing, and then the application comes in the week. Also, I don't think, unless Tom would define this differently, but personally I wouldn't define you need to necessarily go in the set order. I think as long as you've done all three things, that's the important thing.
Are ready for collection in the refreshments area if your kids have been in Fire Kids. So Once you finish receiving ministry, if you can make your way into the refreshments area to collect them.
I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace now like a fetter bind my wandering heart to
next door in the refreshments area. So receive your ministry and then the kids are ready to be collected.
You that if you haven't yet reached the third stage at whatever point you started at, that it's important that you get all three. And so even while you're waiting to be prayed for, if you yet haven't done the third stage of peace between you and relationships, then I want to encourage you right now, even as you are stood there in the room, I'm just going to lead you through a prayer. But Father, I recognize that there's these relationships in my life where I haven't had peace. And I bring these relationships to you, God, right now, and I ask that you would show me the repentance I need to do, God. You would show me the journey I need to go on, a restoration in this place, God. But I hand these relationships to you, and I ask that you would help me to be a peacemaker in this situation, not a peacekeeper, God. Would you help me to step into the tree of life right now in this situation? And would you help me to see the fullness of your restoration in my relationships, God?
when you feel like you've received and you've had enough, you can just make your way out. There's not going to be a formal ending this morning, but just stay in this place. We've got a little bit of more time before we need to be out this morning, and just do business with God. Just tell him what it is that you need. Just receive that peace from him. Yeah, and Father, I just ask that this week we will start to put into operation everything that we've learned this morning about the peace of God. That we would have peace with you, peace with ourselves, and peace with others on a greater measure, in a greater way. Father, I ask that you would just bring deeper revelation of your peace to everyone in this room this week. That we will start to operate in a greater level of this fruit of the Spirit by your guidance and by your leadership, Holy Spirit. I pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.